Hi, I'm Arun George, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. In today's episode, we'll be talking about why the BJP and its former Chief Minister Vasundhara Raje have played a relatively muted role in the political turmoil in Rajasthan. We'll also be looking at the positive initial test results of a vaccine for the SARS-CoV-2 virus that have been successful. But first, we're looking at how Bengaluru, which earlier seemed to be on top of tackling the spread of COVID-19, is currently struggling to ensure care for all those infected. It now seems like a lifetime ago that the central government held up the Karnataka model as one for the other states to imitate when it came to contact tracing and treatment of COVID-19 patients. Since then, the number of cases in the state has shown a consistent rise, as have the number of deaths, with Bengaluru the worst hit. Bengaluru is presently under a week-long lockdown that ends on Wednesday. We've been talking to the Indian Express's Johnson TA, who covers Karnataka for the newspaper, as the situation steadily deteriorated in Bengaluru. And he joins us now to talk about why getting private hospitals to play a greater role has been a problem, the challenges authorities face, and what may have gone wrong. We started by asking Johnson, what's the biggest problem being faced in providing COVID-19 treatment in Bengaluru?
So basically, there's a shortage of beds for COVID-19 patients, especially the moderately ill to the severely ill patients, and especially the ICU ventilator beds, there's a shortage in Bangalore. Basically, in the government sector, they have only about 2,000 beds overall, and about 6,000 has to come from the private sector. And ICU beds, government has at present only 7 to spare. I think they have a total of about 100. And out of that, they have only 7 to spare because everything else is occupied, ICU ventilator beds. And the total number of cases, active cases, is about 26,000. And almost 300 people need ventilator support or an ICU, and they could anytime move into requiring ventilator support. So since the government doesn't have enough beds on its own, it's asking the private sector to give more beds. But although the private sector has said on paper, agreed on paper, to give about 6,000 beds, I think totally they have about 8,500 beds, government and private combined together. But only a very few beds are being given is what the government says. The government says that only about 300 beds from the private sector has been given to them. So they are trying to issue warnings, and CM has called a meeting again, and is saying that they would take over the hospitals, and some two hospitals OPDs were shut because they didn't comply with giving 50% of the beds to the government. So overall, I think private sector has about 358 ICU ventilator beds. So they want them to share, which they've agreed to give to the government on paper. But I think only about 120 of those beds have been occupied by patients. And although it's there on paper, it is not being given to the government. That's the problem that they're trying to solve. Fundamentally, it's a problem of shortage of hospital beds for COVID treatment in Bangalore.
The problem arises also because of how the government and private hospitals are counting the number of COVID-19 patients admitted for treatment. We asked Johnson to break down the problem.
Right now, there's a differentiation. So 50% of all private hospital beds must be reserved for the government. And that the government will refer patients to these hospitals. And the patients referred to the private hospitals by the government, there's a different rate. That is about 5,200 rupees basic for a general bed. There's a second category, 50% of the remaining beds with the hospital, that can be used by the private hospitals at their rate. If it is an insurance, then there is no ceiling on the rate if it's an insurance patient. But if it is a cash patient, the 10,000 rupees for a basic bed. So what the government is saying is that the private hospitals are not showing their full quota of beds. They have about 16,000 beds, but they're showing only about 10,000 beds. So 50% of that bed, of those 10,000 beds, is only 5,000, when they should actually be giving 8,000 beds to the government. And so the private sector is arguing that if we give up all our beds for government patients, then it'll be very difficult to manage our finances and our staff, and we don't have that much staff to look after the patients. So they're still to work out how those 50% of beds has to be given to the government. Is it in ICU ventilator beds? Is it just general beds? That kind of micro level agreement has not been reached. So government says there are 16,000 beds in private, and you must give us 8,000 beds, 50% of that. But private says that we have only about 10,000 beds. We can give only about 5,000 beds in that. But the crux of it, I think, is the ICU ventilator beds, which the government is severely short of. And the private has about 500, 600 beds in total in that. But they've admitted patients only into about 100 beds. So the basic issue is the private is saying you don't look at 50% of our beds as your beds. You look at even the patients we are admitting for COVID-19 as COVID-19 beds. You know, just look at COVID-19 beds. How many beds are there for COVID-19 in all? That is their argument.
Johnson says private hospitals also argue that the prices set by the government are too low.
Although the price has been fixed, patients have a very low slab of rates. And private hospitals are saying that it's about 5,000 rupees for a general COVID-19 bed if you're referred by the government. But the private hospital is saying after the second day, the patient is not able to pay. Because many of them are poor patients also when they go to the private hospitals. You know, second or third day, they say they cannot pay. Then the private hospital has to bear the brunt of the cost for the remaining 10, 11 days of admission that the person will have to undergo. And they say that per day, the PPE kit for one person itself costs about 3,000. So the cost factor is very high. So it does not make economic sense for them to admit large number of government referred patients at government rates. They have a different rate for patients who come in on their own. Then if you're paying cash, I think they have a 25,000, 10,000 ceiling for just a general bed and 25,000 for an ICU ventilator bed. So they prefer that category of patients rather than the category referred by the government where their slabs are much lower. The government is saying that the rates that we fixed in Karnataka is much better than the rates fixed in Delhi or in Bombay.
But like many other cities in India, the pandemic, he says, has revealed the shortcomings of public healthcare.
Here, basically, tertiary care has been outsourced completely to the private sector. There are 16 government hospitals with 10 ventilators. You know, that means that if you want ventilator support, government hospitals, usually they could not give it to you. You had to go to private sector. So, you know, the high-end care has always been given away to the private sector. I think this crisis shows that even there's been a lot of people writing that people have always predicted there's going to be a future pandemic. The only way to prepare for a pandemic is to build up the public healthcare system. Because ventilators, stuff like in the tertiary care, like high-end systems like ventilators, they usually use rarely, you know. So people argue that buying all that and keeping it in storage is just a waste of a thing. And that argument is also there. But many experts say that this pandemic shows that the public healthcare system has to be prepared, you know, geared up, because you cannot rely completely on the private healthcare sector.
The private sector is also accusing the government of not doing enough. But if the number of cases continues to rise at the current rate, Johnson says it will put pressure on the entire healthcare system.
So the problem is going to come going ahead. Now there is only about 26,000 active cases in Bangalore. But if you're going to have about 50,000 in the beginning of August or middle of August, then it's going to be a really serious issue. And if there are more than 1,000 people requiring ICU ventilators, then even the private sector may not be able to cope with the whole problem. The private sector's argument is the government is pushing all the patients onto us. They had 3 months of lockdown to prepare for this situation, but they have not prepared it. They became complacent, thinking the numbers are low. And now the whole thing has blown up and they are putting pressure on the private hospitals.
Another problem the city's healthcare sector is facing is the shortage of staff. And it's one that both the government and private sector are facing.
At one level, there are a lot of nurses and first-line staff, you know, IRs and people who clean wards and, you know, do the running around in the wards for getting things. And a lot of them have been infected. So I think in one hospital, government hospital, they said there are only 2 nurses for 112 patients, one of the government hospitals. So in many hospitals, because people have tested positive, frontline nurses and second-line workers, there is a shortage of staff just because these people are in quarantine. Then in another level, there is also people, when somebody tests positive, a lot of all around them are quarantined. So then that shortage also happens. That happens both in private and in government. Then there's a third level where people are afraid because there are positive cases. They don't turn up for work. So there's an argument that the government is not doing enough, that, you know, they should come forward and say that all the frontline workers are protected, that their families will be protected, that there's an insurance for them. If they fall ill, their life will be protected. So there's one argument in the private hospitals in particular that that kind of private hospital staff are not given the cover that the government hospital staff are being given. So they should be paid extra and, you know, risk allowance should be given to them. Government is planning to introduce risk allowance for the government sector, which is double of their pay for the staff who report to work. So that kind of encouragement is needed even in private sector is what they say. And that government should take responsibility for that. And then you would have more staff working on the front line Also, he reserved facilities for healthcare workers. When they fall ill, they should be in the hospital that they work in itself, some reservation where they are all hospital reserved for them to be treated. That kind of assurances are not really in place.
Johnson says that the private sector is arguing for additional support from the government because of the high cost of treatment involved.
The cost overall is quite high. I think, you know, some of the medium range hospitals which I have seen, they were arguing that in the old days in an ICU, you could have two doctors manning, say, if it's a 30-bed ICU, I think two doctors could man that, and then you would need about per person about 10 PPE kits at 300 rupees per PPE kit. So about 6,000 rupees per day for the doctors. I think they do about 10 changes or something like that. But now they say for every two beds, you need at least one doctor. For every two beds, you need at least one nurse, kind of a thing. So that economics, they're not able to meet, even in the private sector. Many private doctors actually argue for the fact that the government should come and take over these hospitals, pay for the cost of the workers and the equipment and everything. So then you will be able to run the hospital, because many of the private hospitals have a lot of ventilators and things. If the cost is covered, the private hospitals may be willing to give up more beds to the state.
When you mentioned tertiary care and government hospitals, there's also that disturbing number of patients who died after being admitted at the Victoria Hospital in Bengaluru, where they were admitted for tertiary care and even for ventilators. Has there been any further explanation on how this happened and why?
So the main explanation is that many of the patients have comorbidities and they come into the hospital very late. About 38 patients died within 10 hours of admission is what they say. So there were already some efforts which did not go well to give them ventilator support, and then they come into the hospital. So that is what the basic argument of the hospital is, that many of them have, it's basically heart problem and renal failure. That is the source of death rather than the ventilator usage. But there is also another argument in the private sector that, you know, there's something wrong in the intensive care, that it's not being done properly and it's not being monitored regularly on a consistent basis. So that may be something is going wrong in the intensive care of people who are intubated.
Johnson pointed out that the number of deaths in the hospital are quite similar to those seen in other parts of the world in the initial phases of the pandemic.
Victoria is the hospital with the largest number of ventilators. So it is the main COVID-19 hospital. So that may be a factor why so many patients are dying on ventilator over there. Although the ICU mortality is only about 50%, but almost 95-97% of those who put on ventilator seem to have passed away.
Johnson says that out of the 40,000 cases so far in the state, around 26,000 are in Bengaluru alone. The number of cases in other districts are fluctuating, but in Bengaluru, around 2,000 cases are detected daily. The fatality rate and the positivity rate, the number of people dying due to COVID-19 and the number of people testing positive, is almost the same in Bengaluru as the rest of the state. However, the number of deaths per million people in the state capital is nearly 3 times that of the rest of the state. And that, says Johnson, could remain a problem until the issue of getting beds for patients is sorted out.
The concern is that the present rate of infections and number of positive cases every day and number of people needing ICU ventilator support continues to rise. Then if the government does not come to a proper agreement with private sector, then there will be a shortage of beds. And, you know, there is a centralized allocation system that is working now because there is more beds than there is patients to some extent. So something has to be formally agreed by the private and the state government for things to be in order if cases continue to rise at the same rate. Once the lockdown is lifted, there is definitely going to be more cases. And the lockdown is only an opportunity for them to put the healthcare sector in order. It is not really a fix on stopping the spread of the virus.
Johnson says the authorities may have taken it easier earlier because the number of cases was lower. But he says that since there's been a rise in cases, there's been a lot more action on the ground.
I think that laxity that happened in between because the numbers were low, that has been sorted out. I think there's been changes of officials. A lot of people are now in charge at a very local level. IAS officers have been appointed. Then, you know, IAS, IPS officer teams have been appointed to get the private hospitals to share more beds. You know, when the numbers were low, I think there was a lot of complacency and everybody just sat back. And I think the municipal commissioner was transferred out yesterday because they felt that he had not been able to meet the challenge effectively. So now there are even ward level committees to, you know, have strategies at the ward level itself on containing the virus. So there's a lot more effort now focused on Bangalore. So that should have some positive results going ahead.
A week-long lockdown in Bengaluru ends on Wednesday. But Johnson says there's a difference in opinion if that's the right call.
There is two opinions on that. The chief minister seems inclined at getting back to normal activities from Wednesday. But the experts and a few ministers in the government have been saying that a one-week lockdown is not enough. Basically, if you're looking at it from an epidemiology point of view, and if you're looking at it from breaking the cycle of spread, then you need at least a three-week lockdown is their argument. But the maximum it may go is from, I think, Wednesday to Sunday. That will be about a two-week lockdown, and then they'll get back to normal activities. But the thing is that the lockdown period has to be used to scale up the healthcare infrastructure is the thinking, rather than to break the cycle of the spread of the virus.
So what efforts have been made to increase capacity? Here's what Johnson had to say.
I think they have got ventilators from PM CARES Fund, and so there are about 640 plus some they procured on their own. There are about 700. Those have to be installed and those facilities have to be up and running. So there are no technicians to run those things. So they are going on an emergency hiring spree of people, training them, getting them trained to use ventilators. So all those government hospitals in Bangalore which don't have ventilators will all probably get ventilators. So they're doing the civil works, building up the ICU rooms now for that kind of thing. So that may take about another month to be up and running.
Before we get to the next segment, I just wanted your quick attention. One of the big reasons people say that they like this show is because it helps them understand the news better. It provides them with the context they need to see the bigger picture. And there's perhaps no other place that does this better than the Indian Express's Explained section. We on Three Things refer to the section regularly, and it helps us make this show. If you're a regular reader of the newspaper, you know how useful the Explain section can be, especially when you're looking for in-depth analysis by the right experts. You can log into indianexpress.com/explained and access their coverage 24/7. Explained by the Indian Express, where news that matters is explained by experts who know the subject. Now, back to the show. It's been over a week since Sachin Pilot and a group of rebel MLAs left Rajasthan. Since then, Pilot's been dismissed as deputy chief minister and two of his supporters who were ministers were sacked. As Manoj CG said in a previous episode, the Congress hasn't ruled out Pilot returning to the party as long as he makes no demands and announces that he has no links with the BJP. The link to that episode is in the description of today's episode. The Rajasthan High Court has said it will continue hearing on Tuesday a petition filed by Pilot and the rebel MLAs that challenges the disqualification notices that was issued to them by the Assembly Speaker. However, what's been equally surprising is the BJP's relative silence on the political developments. The party's former chief minister, Vasundhara Raje, isn't seen to be actively trying to form the government. The party isn't even pushing for a test of the government's majority just yet. We're now speaking with the Indian Express's Liz Matthew, who covers the BJP, about how it's operating in the current scenario. So Liz, while the Congress has maintained that the BJP is behind the current political crisis in Rajasthan, why is the BJP staying in the background so far?
See, initially BJP did not want to be seen as a force that is working behind Sachin Pilot. So they prefer to project it as an internal crisis in the Congress, which was suitable for them. Because since the Gehlot government was formed after 2018 election, there were voices of discord within the Congress. And there was Kaun Banega Mukhyamantri issue was also there. So it suited BJP to project and, you know, present it as a crisis inside the Congress. Just like what happened in Madhya Pradesh, they chose to make people believe that this is something within the Congress and the Congress is disintegrating and the leadership has failed to keep its leadership. Like Jyotiraditya Scindia came out with 21 MLAs. Here somebody else is coming out. Another young leader is coming out and splitting the Congress. And asking BJP to help the formation of the government, or the BJP as a responsible opposition party who try to avoid constitutional crisis or, like, you know, political crisis in the state. And so we will step in. Any opposition party would like to dethrone the rival's dispensation and form the government. This was BJP's plan. And this was what BJP wanted to. But as we know, neither in Madhya Pradesh nor in Rajasthan, it happened without the BJP's background support, or, you know, the discussions were on. Senior BJP leaders were involved in the discussion in Madhya Pradesh to get all the 21 MLAs along with Jyotiraditya Scindia. The same way, these people's role were played behind the screen, and they wanted to be like that till Sachin has come out with adequate number. This was BJP's plan in the beginning. But obviously, when things were not working according to what they expected, the party leaders, out of frustration or out of, like, you know, political unavoidability, they had to come out, giving Congress a chance to say that, see, this is what we have been saying. The BJP has been playing the role of, like, you know, disrupting the government in Rajasthan. And there were conversation, and they came out with so-called tapes, audio clips and all.
So how has the BJP reacted to these tapes and all these allegations that have come up against it?
In the first day, interestingly, they were on a defensive. The first day they said that the voice is not ours, and the leader who the Congress claimed, the union minister, said that neither the language nor the diction nor the voice is mine. Second day, they were on offensive. The BJP early morning, you know, around 10 o'clock, held a press conference and said, did the Rajasthan government, Ashok Gehlot government, follow the procedures, the laid down procedures for tapping the phone? Because not everybody can tap the phone. And by evening, they came out and said that they did not follow the procedures. They tried to put the blame on the Congress government for the so-called phone tapping. So they changed the goalpost. And they obviously tried to put the Congress in a bad light. For your crisis, for your internal crisis, you are blaming. And, you know, to add to the BJP's woes in a way, that Sachin Pilot kept repeating that I am not going to join BJP. Joining BJP is not my option. That also make BJP a little more on a slippery wicket, because the plan, or how the leaders were expecting that Sachin would come out with so many MLAs, then the BJP can support, or BJP can consider another political realignment in the state, which did not work. So the BJP had to play the offensive card immediately.
But, you know, you say that the BJP is playing this offensive card, but Vasundhara Raje, who's been the CM face of the party for years now, is suddenly out of the limelight. So why is she staying out of it so far?
That is another internal issue of the BJP. One, Vasundhara Raje, as we have seen in the last term of BJP also, the current national leadership and the then national leadership and Vasundhara Raje were not considered to be sharing good ties. And Vasundhara Raje had at that time adequate number of MLA, so the leadership could not do anything. They had to agree to she continuing as the chief minister and the tallest leader of BJP there. And she had the mass support also. But after the defeat of BJP in the 2018 election, the things have changed. BJP, like in Madhya Pradesh, BJP's leadership is now key on bringing up another set of leadership, because Chauhan had 3 terms. Vasundhara Raje also had multiple terms. So they want another leadership to come up, a fresh leadership. Also, the senior leaders in the party who have put their years of hard work and, you know, dedication to the party, they feel that they have been completely overshadowed by Vasundhara Raje. And the party leadership's decision to always give her the chance kind of dwarfed us. And we did not get our due. Whether it is Narottam Misra or Narendra Singh Tomar in Madhya Pradesh and the other BJP leaders in the south, you know, now that BJP is trying to project Gajendra Shekhawat, the union minister, as one leader. So we have seen that Vasundhara Raje has been silent. The party sources say that even the statements she came out with very late, those statements, like, you know, supporting the party and blaming the Congress, that also was after a lot of pressure. And she was not ready to, like, come up with what they wanted her to say. And she is still acting on her own. And according to people close to Vasundhara Raje, the party did not keep her in the loop when they were planning this so-called political attempt to break the Congress or attempt to get more people from the Congress. She was not in the loop. And at the same time, if she comes in and takes up a lead role, then obviously any failure of that effort will be falling on her. So she did not want to take this thing. And also party leaders say that Vasundhara Raje is not at all keen to pull down Ashok Gehlot government. According to an NDA leader, Hanuman Nirmal came out publicly and accused Vasundhara Raje of helping Gehlot government. So this is more or less an internal issue in the BJP.
So Sachin Pilot himself keeps saying that he's not joining the BJP. As you said, there's a sort of mixed signals from the BJP on who's even the leader of this charge. How can the BJP hope to come to power in the state from this current scenario?
See, as of now, BJP doesn't have any chance to come to power in the state because the Ashok Gehlot's MLAs have already declared their support to the chief minister and they said that they will be remaining with him. And BJP says that 21 MLAs are with Sachin Pilot, although we know only 19. And there are two other independents, like the Om Prakash Hutla and Suresh Thak. These two, if you add, then there are the 19 plus 2, 21. Then BJP has 72 and RLP has 3. Altogether, this is the maximum as of now BJP can get. That is 96 in 200 member assembly. So although it is little narrow margin, Ashok Gehlot still enjoys the majority in the assembly. And that is why BJP is not even asking for a floor test. Only if you have numbers, you know, if you are sure of the members, you can ask for a floor test so that they can vote the government out. But that is not happening. So as of today, but as some BJP leaders said, including Gajendra Shekhawat said, the game is not concluded yet. It is going on. And the BJP has not given up its attempt to see an alternate government. But obviously, Vasundhara Raje's reluctance and the kind of absence of a unanimous stand on this in the state unit will definitely cripple BJP's attempts.
On Monday, scientists at Oxford University said that an early trial of the experimental coronavirus vaccine had prompted a protective immune response in hundreds of people who got the shot. The testing began in April on around 1,000 people, with around half of them getting the experimental vaccine. In a paper published in the journal Lancet, researchers said that they found that the experimental vaccine produced a dual immune response in people aged between 18 and 55, and that response lasted at least 2 months after they were immunized. The experimental vaccine was found to prompt the body to create neutralizing antibodies to the virus. The vaccine was also found to cause a reaction in the body's T cells, which helps destroying the cells that have been taken over by the virus. The experimental vaccine was also said to have caused minor side effects like fever, chills, and muscle pain. There are now much bigger trials taking place in the UK, South Africa, and Brazil. Another big trial is stated to start in the US soon with around 30,000 people. This is just one of the nearly two dozen vaccines that are under development against the SARS-CoV-2 virus across the world. However, a researcher with the Oxford team said that even if all the future trials went well, immunization of some high-risk groups in Britain could begin no earlier than December. Experts have also cautioned that it's too early for optimism given tests still need to be performed on larger populations. The World Health Organization was equally cautious in its optimism, saying that there was a long way to go. And here's what the Director General of the WHO had to say.
We do not have to wait for a vaccine. We have to save lives now. Make no mistake, we must continue to accelerate vaccine research while doing more with the tools we have at hand.
You were listening to Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show, as always, was edited and mixed by our producer Joshua Thomas. Before we go, here's another reminder to check out Indian Express's Explained page. You can log on to indianexpress.com/explained and find in-depth analysis by the right experts. It has everything you need to know and understand the news better and see the bigger picture. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it. Share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can also tweet to us at Express Audio and write to us at podcasts@theRateIndianExpress.com.